Good afternoon, everyone. And today's topic is defining your identity, right? And you might be thinking, how come today there is no poster? I don't see those countdown happening. That's because Ali is here in Mysore. Here is Ali for you.
Yes, thankfully now, with the way technology has gone, it makes no difference where you are. You can be anywhere and speak to anybody, connect with anyone and do whatever you feel like doing. So that is the advantage of technology. But is technology also taking away your identity? Is technology making you feel that you are part of a huge, you know, group or a gang or whatever you want to call it, thereby you lose your identity? This has been something which has been of interest to me, and I have been noticing that the advancement of technology is in some ways eroding our identity. So that is what prompted me to talk about this topic today. And I felt that we should look into what is my specific identity, what I am as an individual, who am I, what am I, and as I sometimes jokingly ask, why am I? That I think is a very, very deep and interesting question. Who am I? Okay, to some extent, some of us can answer. What am I is much easier to answer. But why am I? That is something that is not at all easy to answer. Anyway, I'll take it step by step. You know that this great philosopher Nietzsche said that I think, therefore I am. Because I have the power of thinking, that is why I exist. And that is where I have an identity. Because every individual thinks differently. Be it a parent and child, be it twins, be it spouse, anybody who is thinking, thinks independently. Even great people have spoken about, you know, when they were tortured, for example. Somebody was put in jail and somebody was put into miserable conditions. You know how they survived? They said, you can only control my body. You cannot control my mind. You may put me in jail, you may have 10-foot high walls, you may put barbed wire, you may do anything you want, but my mind can roam free. You cannot control me. And that is the beauty of the mind. The mind is a very, very independent identity. And what our mind does actually defines our identity. But the problem is that people confuse when I ask them, who are you? They confuse with somebody asking them, what are you? Let us start with that basic understanding. Those of you who have done DCS will recall that before even your classes start, I put you onto a questionnaire. And the first question in that questionnaire is, who are you? The moment I ask, who are you? Some people come out with amazing answers. As I always say, I learn from my friends, my students, my counselees, even people whom I interact with on a casual basis. From all these people, I learn a lot of things. But The important thing is that instead of defining or trying to define who I am, a number of us succumb to answering what I am. I have these great achievers who, when I ask them, who are you? They give me their profession. I am a teacher. I am a software engineer. I am a banker. Now that defines what are you. That does not define who you are. Those are only the roles that you are playing. The roles do not define you for the simple reason that your roles keep changing all the time. All the time, your roles keep changing. And when your role changes, your identity does not change. That is the important thing to keep in mind. So today, if you are a software engineer, tomorrow you may be something totally different, isn't it? Today, if you are holding a particular designation, a lot of people, I'm surprised, even identify themselves by their designation. When I'm doing some workshops for some of the, you know, corporate type of people, if I ask them spontaneously, without giving them notice, tell me, who are you? Without batting an eyelid, the gentleman says, I am senior vice president in charge of South Asia. Whether you are senior vice president or junior vice president, whether you are vice president or deputy president or no president, whether you are in charge of South Asia or North Asia, that is only a role that you are playing, and that keeps changing. And because sometimes, unfortunately, people connect their identity so much with their work, their designation, their profession, and that is the reason why if something goes wrong, they are lost. The senior vice president who loses his job almost feels that he no longer exists. But he does. It doesn't make a difference. I come across a lot of ladies who I ask, who are you? And they say, I am a homemaker and I am a mother of two children. If you were not a homemaker, if you were not a mother of two children, if you did not have children at all, or if you had three children, would you be a different person in terms of your identity? No, you wouldn't be different. You would be the same. And that is what I keep reminding people, that please do not connect your identity with the roles that you are playing. Neither do the roles define you, nor do they remain constant. In fact, there are so many people, ladies, who, when we ask, you know, who are you or something like that, they say, I'm just a housewife. Underline the word, just a housewife. What do you exactly mean by just a housewife? Why doesn't the senior vice president say, I'm just a senior vice president? Because here again, I want to emphasize that you are putting too much importance to your role. So the person who feels that I do not have a designation automatically feels that I am just a housewife. Now, the third part of it I mentioned to you. Who are you? What are you? And why are you? I just want to explain the difference between who you are and what you are. What you are is your profession, your designation, the role that you are playing. You are a full-time mother and you are you know, totally involved in your role as a mother, all that comes under what are you. But who are you has to define yourself, right? And then comes this question, why are you, whatever you are, why are you there? Even when we are talking about designations, I am a teacher, I am a software engineer, why are you? I've asked this very, very often when, for example, I am dealing with, teachers. Every year some schools invite me to do an orientation program, before the actual academic year starts and before the students come. Teachers are called in a few days earlier and they go through orientation. Sometimes they invite me also to take a session. And I ask them some very basic question. Let's say, okay, how many of you are, let's say, history teachers? Some hands go up. I look at one of them and say, ma'am, you're a history teacher? Yes, sir. Why? I didn't get you, sir. What do you mean, why? Now I'm asking you, why are you a history teacher? Oh, that way you're asking. Sir, I did my BA with history, sociology and political science. Then I wanted to do, sociology as my major, but then there was no proper college. So I had to opt for history. Then I did my MA with history. I'm a good student, sir. I got a first class even in my post-graduation and this. And after that, people said, with an MA in history, what sort of job you will get? So go and do B.Ed. So I went and did my B.Ed. And then I joined this very prestigious school. And I am very, very happy that I am a very acknowledged history teacher. Now you see the irony of it? I asked, why are you a history teacher? Why are you an architect? Why are you a doctor? Why are you a software engineer? And people can only tell me the sequence of how they landed up there. They are not in a position to tell me what gave them even that identity of being a history teacher. If a history teacher answers, sometimes they do, saying that right from childhood, I have been fascinated with history. I felt that history teaches us so much. History helps us understand human beings. History helps us understand relationships. So somehow I had this feeling that instead of doing anything else, I must be a historian. And once I master history, I must teach history to others. So the younger generation comes to know the importance of knowing human behavior, learning from the mistakes of others. So that is why I did this. And today I'm a history teacher. And as a history teacher, I am teaching human behavior. I am teaching relationships. I am teaching management of emotions. I am teaching empathy to my students. Yes, that is what makes me very, very happy. Those are the people who meaningfully answer, why are you? So whatever may be your answer, supposing you ask yourself this question, who am I? And you give yourself an answer. Write it down on a paper or on the notepad of your mobile so that you don't miss it later. Because very often we tend to change and say, no, this is not what I was thinking, or this is not what I said. So write it down. Let it be there in black and white. And then ask, why are you whatever you said you am? Even a simple thing like, I'm a homemaker. I'm a mother of two children. Why are you a mother of two children? I'm not talking about the biological aspect of having given birth to two children. I am talking about, why do you consider your role as a mother to be your primary role? If you understand that, your life becomes very, very meaningful. And that is why I always say that your identity is a combination of your physical being, your mental stroke emotional being, and your spiritual being. physical being. I am born and brought up in India, so I am a proud Indian. I live in this particular city because I like this city. I live in an apartment or an independent house because I prefer that to the other one. I stay in such and such locality because these facilities are there, or my friends or relatives are close by. All these things constitute my physical being. Some of them you have control over, some of them you don't have control over. Now, I would like to live in another city or another locality, but I can't afford it. I can't move out from here. So I accept it that I'm not in physically an ideal environment, but I'm adapting myself to that environment, knowing that I cannot bring about a major change in my physical setup or environment or whatever it is. Much, much more important is the mental or emotional state. That's what I told you in the beginning. Your physical state can be controlled by others. Your boss does not give you enough money that you can afford to buy a bigger house. Your children are studying somewhere, so you can't afford to go to another locality because school will be too far for them. So like that, there are many, many, many limitations on your physical being. And I always recommend that the faster you start adapting, accepting, not tolerating, accept the things that you cannot change. Have it as a long-term goal. Maybe someday I'll have big money. Maybe someday my children will grow up and go away. Maybe I will not have this financial limitations. That time I'll bring about a change. But today, knowing that I have that limitation, let me accept it and make the most of it. But how do you make the most of it? By your mental state, your emotional state. People in the same situation. There are people who have 10 crores in the bank and they say, I'm financially insecure. I don't think that money will last me the rest of my life. And there are people who have 10,000 rupees in their bank and they say, it's okay, I have 10,000. I'll add on to it, I'll do more and more to it. I'm not bankrupt, I'm not starving. So it's good enough. See how your mental state is completely in your control. You can do whatever you want. I even extended to talking about physical pain. There is somebody who has got physical pain and is screaming away to glory and complaining. There are people who go through severe pain and yet they say, yes, there is pain, but I can tolerate it. I can put my mind on to something else. So see how the mind controls the body. And when the mind is given the free hand to control the body, your very being becomes different. Your identity becomes different. And the third aspect, as I told you, is the spiritual being. At a spiritual level, what am I? Who am I? What sort of a spiritual being am I? And please let me make it very clear, when I say spiritual, I'm not talking about religion. You may even be an atheist and yet be a spiritual being. You may be a person who performs all the rituals of your faith or community, but you may not be a spiritual being. So what you are as a spiritual being, meaning to say, do I look at life beyond what is happening to me now? Do I have a long-term holistic vision? If I do, then I am a spiritual being. Okay, what makes a difference between these things? It starts with your upbringing. What was your upbringing? We can never deny. I always keep reminding people that our upbringing, the first few years of our life, play a very, very important role. In fact, from the lockdown onwards, when I had extra time, I have worked on a therapy, which I have given a name, Roots Therapy. Meaning to say, the therapy that I need to undergo, what is therapy? It is healing. So whatever type of healing that I need to go through depends on my roots. What do I mean by roots? My upbringing, my early years. It makes so much of a difference. So much of our value system, our morals, our attitudes, and our choices, decisions, depend on our upbringing. So if you have not done it recently, please go back into your past. Those who have done DCS will recall, as we went through that questionnaire, IAQ questionnaire, after asking you, you know, who are you? I asked you to recall, what was the saddest event in your life? What was a happy event in your life? What are you feeling regretful about? Given a choice and no restrictions, what would you like to do with your life? These are questions which help you not only to define your identity, but to give a direction to your identity, to give you that courage to stand by your beliefs, your values, to go against the tide. If you can do that, if you can have a mind of your own which says, let the whole world say what they want, do what they want. If I sincerely, genuinely believe in something, if my conscience is clear, I will do it. I won't fight against the rest of the world. See, that's where a difference comes in. Supposing I find that people around me are doing something which I do not agree with, which goes against my value system or whatever attitudes, I don't have to declare war on them. All I have to do is to say, unto you, your way, unto me, my way. I will not get influenced by what you are doing and follow you like the herd mentality. And at the same time, I will not fight with you, argue with you, declare you as an enemy. There's so much space in the world for every one of us to have our own thinking, our own identity, our own way. And at the most, what can others do to you? What I told in the beginning, they can put limitations on your body, on your physical being, but they cannot put limitations on your mental and emotional and spiritual way. Now, taking that into account, you should understand, if you are running away from your identity, people say it's very difficult to, you know, go against the tide. When everybody believes in something, how can I go against it? You don't have to. You have to just derail yourself from that beaten path and find a road less traveled. The title of one of my most favorite books by Scott Peck, The Road Less Traveled. There's always a road less traveled which is available to you. If there it isn't, you can create a road. You can create your own path, as long as you don't run away or hide behind your identity. As long as you do not go by the herd mentality. As long as you do not succumb to things like superstition, people making you feel guilty about something. How can you not do this? How can you do this? You have to find that identity of your own. I keep mentioning that one of the psychotherapists whose work I greatly admire and follow a lot of what he has said is Dr. Carl Rogers. C-A-R-L, Carl, R-O-G-E-R-S, Rogers. Dr. Carl Rogers' most famous book is on becoming a person. What a funny title, no? On becoming a person. What do we mean? I am a person, am I not? No. Carl Rogers says, to become a fully functional, independent person, you have to work towards it. What I told you, resist pressures, keep away from peer pressure. Do not agree to something just because 100 people are saying it. And this is what takes you through from the best to the worst situations. Even if something happens and you face failure or you face a setback, you even go into depression because things have gone very bad. If you have a mind of your own, and if you believe that you have an identity of your own, then you will not succumb to all these things that are happening, isn't it? And to be able to do that, don't allow yourself to get pushed. That, I think, is the crux of developing and sustaining an identity of your own. Along with that, let me also caution you that your identity changes with time. Today, what I am is definitely not what I was 20 years or 40 years back. When you are a child, your identity is different. When you are adolescent, your identity is different. When you are an adult, your identity is different. When you acquire a different attitude towards life, when you get certain revelations about life, your identity changes according to that. So once you start working on recognizing your identity, connecting to your identity, and sticking to your identity, also be open to change. There are various things in that. This is not the platform for me to tell you. For example, you want to really understand yourself. One of the finest tools is what is called as the Johari window. J-O-H-A-R-I. Johari window is such a simple but such an effective tool that helps you to constantly keep reviewing and finding out where you are. It also, unlike what people believe, it gives you a sense of belonging. It gives you a sense of belonging to the right people. That is very important. But unfortunately, many of us succumb to what, you know, is our identity with regard to the most convenient or the most popular one. That is where we lose out. We do not understand and accept that if I'm working in a particular office and there is a particular type of atmosphere, particular type of gossiping, particular type of attitude or corruption or whatever it is, I don't have to follow that. I can work in that office because I need the job, but I can still maintain my identity. I can still have a mind of my own. And these are very, very simple but highly effective tools by which you can work towards, firstly, understanding yourself, identifying who you are, not what you are. Reinforcing that, making sure that you've done that identification for the right reasons. And finally, when you have that and you are on the right boat or the right vehicle, hold the rudder or the steering and say, I will change directions according to my need and according to what I feel is right. As long as I keep doing that, I will lead a quality of life which will be far superior to others who have wrong notions of happiness, success, achievement. Someday or the other, they do fall back. But if you follow these very basic, simple tools, techniques, whatever I'm telling you, life will throw any number of ups and downs. You may have any number of hurdles and challenges, but your head will be above the water. You will not drown. You will continue to move on. Okay, so that is my message I wanted to convey to you. As usual, I'll take a 1 minute break and Sonal is here to update you on what's happening.
Hello and good afternoon to everyone. What a deep topic, right? Generally, we just identify ourselves with the work we do, but this is beyond that. Lovely. As we have come here to Mysore, I would like to just tell you what is the purpose of coming to Mysore. We came 2-3 days back and we have been having back-to-back appointments. This time Ali said we will go there and offer free counseling to people over there. And you won't believe there are so many of them who are interested in knowing about their career. Isn't it wonderful to give this service in Mysore, coming over, staying in this peaceful environment and doing counseling. And as you know, when you do career counseling, there is something personal also that comes up. So there's so satisfying, I would say this visit has been so satisfying over here. And we are going to have, Ali is going to have a talk in the evening at a book club over here. Book club, yes. People over here do read books and they have a club and they have called Ali to give a talk on mental health, right? Being in Mysore and still talking about mental health, it would be really amazing. I feel it's like, you know, using first aid before even you think that something is going to come up. That's life in Mysore. It's what I have heard from one of our alumni, Sanhita, who has been staying here. And she had come to meet us and she has praised about the life in Mysore so much that Dr. Nikhat, who has accompanied over here with us, she also is thinking that, hey, why not we shift over here? Yeah, I think I'll turn the camera to her and she can also say hi to all of you.
Hello from Mysore.
So I think it's time for Ali to get back. Yeah, at the end, I'll tell you what will be the next topic of this FB next week, next Saturday. What will be the topic? At the end, I will tell you. And good afternoon to all of you who have been wishing all of us. And back to Ali.
Yes. And you know what? I am looking forward to see whether your comments, questions, and insights will help me to improve my sense of my identity. So let's start off with that. We have Nikhat who is reading out the questions or the comments, and I will keep responding to it.
Asha Chandra Prabha says, do spiritual people carry any baggage?
Not necessarily. And Asha, one very nice thing is purely spiritual, because I made it very clear that spiritual is nothing to do with religious. So please spend some time exploring, finding out and forming the right identity of spirituality. And then if you say that I am a spiritual person, actually, the interesting thing is you shed your baggage. See, people who are not spiritual get caught up in today, the now. People who are spiritual, they look at the bigger picture of life. They can look up at the vast sky and look at the millions of stars and say, in those millions or billions of stars, there is one star called the sun. and that star has got 9 planets and Earth is one of them. In that one planet, out of 8 billion people, I'm one of them. So what does it make a difference whether I'm achieving something, whether I'm overtaking something? You know how you can look at the bigger picture. So you actually shed your baggage when you become more and more spiritual.
Next is my own comment. We've been conditioned so strongly in early years that it takes a lifetime and lots of introspection to find our identity.
Yes, we have been conditioned. In fact, that's what I told you earlier also. Why I came out with this roots therapy, to drive home the point that we, a lot of what we are as adults depends on the type of upbringing we had. So I keep telling people, if you want to keep in touch with your identity and, you know, have a stronger hold on your identity, do not ignore your upbringing. Periodically go back to your early childhood and list out what were the inputs given to you and how they are affecting you today. That is how you need to move forward from time to time, and you will find that you will be able to, you know, go through this whole process of evolving, growing, understanding, changing, etc. Right?
Aditi Datta says, I'm still in search of my identity. It changes so often with time.
Exactly, Aditi. I'm really glad that you admit that. Not many people do it. They think I have formed an identity. And I told you, no, identity very often goes with the group. I am an Indian. I am a Hindu, a Christian, or whatever it is. I am a member of Rotary Club. I am this. I am an award winner of such and such a thing. That is not your identity. So people like Aditi, who frankly admit that number one, I am in search of my identity, and number two, my identity keeps changing every now and then. So I will also keep moving with the flow.
Sunil is asking, how do you develop identity in childhood?
Oh yes, though it is difficult, it's not impossible. If you have a child who is under your influence, I request you, teach autonomy to the child. Teach the child to think for himself. Teach the child to look beyond textbook answers. Life does not have textbook answers. We can do a great favor to any child by just encouraging, motivating the child to develop that autonomy, to have a mind of your own. If we keep suppressing that and saying, you are small, you are stupid, you are not capable, I will tell you what to do, that's the greatest disservice that you can do. On the other hand, if you encourage a child to find his or her own identity, then the advantage is that the child will grow up finding her own identity, evolving into the identity as she comes to adulthood.
Sonal also says, a lot of youngsters say, I have an identity crisis. What would they be meaning?
That's become a little fad nowadays. You know, these are these fads that go around. One of the most common one that, you know, we keep hearing recently, I'm sure many of you have heard words like narcissistic or gaslighting. These things existed. They existed 1,000 years, 5,000 years back. But somebody comes out with this and everybody is talking about narcissistic personality. We even now have narcissistic trauma dealing with them therapists who charge a bomb to help you to deal with narcissism. Nothing like that. So understand that these trends, these fads, which people say, I have an identity crisis. Nobody has an identity crisis as long as what Aditi said, I am searching for my identity.
Aditi
perfectly
also,
okay. Yes, go ahead.
Aditi also says, I'm grateful to my mother who gave me the autonomy of doing things the way I wanted. It shaped today's me.
That's right. That's right. I think that's a great thing. And I hope every growing child gets this type of opportunities as you grow up. Hats off to your mother, Aditi. Pratiksha is asking, is identity linked to our purpose in life? Not directly, but if you are able to come as close as possible to understand your identity, you can create a better purpose in life. That's what I said, that, you know, looking at the bigger picture. So people who are caught up by saying that I am deputy general manager, I should become general manager. That becomes a purpose of life. And instead of becoming general manager, if he's thrown out of his job, he goes berserk. So if you can develop an identity, it will help you to find to life. Sorry, I got disconnected for a moment. It will help you to find your deeper purpose in life.
Sonal is also asking, identity keeps changing. How long does it keep changing?
No, there's nothing fixed like that. There are people whose identity keeps changing very frequently. There are those who stay. It's something like careers. People change careers. Some people stick to the same career. So every individual, and that is the beauty of human being. That's what I told you in the beginning. Every one of us is individual and we should find our own answers. Nitya has asked a very good question. How is identity different from ego? Identity is to understand who I am, what I am, why I am, and create a holistic picture. Ego, unfortunately, is the tool by which you turn everything inward. So when you come across somebody and, you know, they say, oh, this fellow has got a bloated ego. What does it mean? He cannot see beyond his nose. He thinks the world starts and ends with him. He thinks he's the most important person in his life. And that actually, the interesting thing is, anybody who's got a bloated ego cannot find his identity. Because he's already put on the mask of the ego saying that I'm the most important person. So he will obviously not look for an identity. Right?
I found this quote by Oscar Wilde, which says, most people are other people. Their thoughts are someone else's opinions. Their lives are mimicry and their passions are quotation.
Very well said. Very, very well said. And that is why I keep saying, let the whole world say something. Introspect. Think deeper. Talk to your own conscience. Yes, maybe talk to a few knowledgeable people. I'm not saying that you should live in isolation as an individual. You should talk to knowledgeable people. And understand that knowledgeable people don't go around unnecessarily, you know, trying to influence others. The truly knowledgeable people don't behave like some of the gurus do, that they try to convert you to their way of thinking. If you ask them, they will tell you, this is what I believe in, take it or leave it. Those are the wonderful people. There are many of them around, but they are modest, they are humble, and they keep to themselves. When you identify such people, take their opinions, particularly in the areas where they have an expertise. Yes.
Where does one start the journey of finding their identity?
As I told you, ideally you can start in childhood if you get the opportunity. But now, as Aditi said a little while back, that she was very lucky to have a mother who encouraged her to find her identity. As Sonal was saying, we have spent 3 days constantly talking about various things, but one of the themes was career guidance. And we find that so many are thrust into that herd mentality. You should become a doctor, you should become an engineer. You should take coaching for NEET, you should take coaching for JEE. The world is so much beyond. So if there are parents, teachers, adults who tell a child, you find your identity, you find your direction, you look for what you want to do, is very good. If for some reason you have been unfortunate, and during your growing up years when you were dependent on your adults, you did not get that freedom. Now you are an adult. And as an adult, people can't influence you the way they could influence you when you were a child, right? So at least now start the process of thinking for your own self. It takes courage, it takes practice, but it is not impossible.
Sonal is saying many people use ChatGPT while writing about themselves or make their own CVs. Can you throw some light on this?
Oh yes, yes, yes. This ChatGPT has become something, you know, very fascinating. And I am sitting in one corner, far away from the world of technology, quietly observing what it is doing. Like with any other thing, ChatGPT or AI itself, artificial intelligence itself, is a wonderful tool. Okay? But a tool can be used for good and can be used for bad. The knife is a tool, very effective tool if it's a nicely sharpened knife. You can cut vegetables at full speed and see that your food is cooked properly. You can use the knife to stab somebody. So is the knife a good thing or a bad thing? No. Knife is a knife. It is how you use it. So when you talk artificial intelligence, when you talk ChatGPT, you want to use it as a tool to enhance your efficiency, it is fine. But if you surrender to artificial intelligence and think that artificial intelligence will tell me what I'm going to do, you are making a gross mistake. And once you make the mistake, you get back to what I told you, that type of herd mentality. When you talk about artificial intelligence, I want to ask only one question. What is happening to your real intelligence? That was a gift from creation, right? As a fetus, as a baby, you are given that power to think. Why do you want to give it up? Why do you want to surrender it? A vehicle is an excellent means of reaching somewhere faster. But if you become so dependent on a vehicle that you forget how to walk, imagine what is going to happen. The same thing is happening with artificial intelligence. There are people who are going to benefit immensely in 100 different ways. And there are people who are going to lose their real intelligence to artificial intelligence. Yes, Smita has a good point. A personal emotional crisis situation often makes you come to a screeching halt and relook into who you really are. Yes, Smita, as a counselor, you, I, we all go through, you know, counselees who have this type of a situation, no? An emotional crisis. And we realize that our counselees are suddenly rethinking. But I have only one word to say. Bring about change when there is no compulsion to bring about a change. If you are in a good job and you are comfortable and you've been working for years, start thinking whether it is advisable to bring about a change and go for another job or a better job. You wait till the day you lose your job and then you start looking for a job. It's a crisis situation. And that is my, what do you say, suggestion or advice to people, that crisis will come, challenges will come, setbacks will come. But there will be long periods in between when there will be no crisis, when there will be no setback. Take advantage of that.
Sunil is also asking, how much does defining one's identity help in developing social connects?
Yeah, social connect is entirely your choice. You may decide, I don't want to get into social connect. I have a selected number of people, my family members, my immediate, whatever, close friends and all these things. So, I will stick to that. I don't want to go beyond that. But why is it that I'm doing it? There are some people who do not have good social contacts because they don't have confidence in themselves. Or they say, I've been cheated by friends, so therefore I don't want to make friends. Those are the wrong reasons for social isolation. There are people who say, I value human beings. I value relationships. I've got some very, very close and very, you know, meaningful relationships. So I don't need to look beyond. In that, the only thing that I would say is, don't put all your eggs in one basket. That's the only thing.
Anything
else? Okay. So with that, let me move on to sort of summing up after all the comments and everything that I have heard from you. And some of them have been really meaningful. After this, I am going to jot it down and incorporate it in some of my own future thinkings and all these things. Start with the fact that review your childhood, what you went through, what could have influenced you. There may be superstition, there may have been good or bad moral, there may have been values, there have been relationships, whatever it may be. Learn to disengage your baggage and get free so that you can move on with wherever you want. Before you move on, when you come to a crossroad, what do? You first check, should I go straight, should I go left, should I go right? That is what finding your identity is. Which road leads me to the best destination that I want? Once you decide on that, then you can move on to choosing the right path. When you start choosing the path, don't get stuck by saying, I have chosen the right path, so the rest of my life I'll keep walking on that path. As some of you rightly pointed out, your identity, your goals in life, your priorities in life change. And before those changes cause some sort of a crisis for you, become proactive, redefine your identity and start moving on. If you follow these very simple things, I am not teaching you rocket science. I have not said anything in the past hour which you don't know, but it is hidden somewhere. We don't bring it out and actually put it into effect. My continuous request to all of you who spend your Saturdays or even later catching up with the program any other time is to tell yourself, even if there's one tip that I learned from these Saturday sessions, I am going to implement it. The moment you know that you have implemented it and you move on, see the change that comes in your life. Okay, so with that, I will sign off and Sonal will quickly update you on the next week program, etc. And then see you. Bye bye.
Yes, every topic gives some insight, some food for thought. And actually, if you see, if you're listening to Ali's talk every Saturday, you are actually working towards defining your identity, isn't it? If you introspect, you are doing that. So wish you all the very best. And the 24th of August, the next week, Saturday, we are going to have the topic handling long distance relationship. In today's world where technology is growing and people are, you know, all over the world, somebody is working in one country, somebody's child is studying in some other country, mother is working in some other country, yet how do you keep that relationship intact? Let's hear from Ali and team next Saturday on handling long distance relationship. See you all next week.